welcome to A Celtic State of Mind. I'm Paul John Dykes, and today I'm delighted to be joined on the ACSOM Bulletin by Tony Haggerty and Amy Canavan. We'll be looking back on the slender 1-0 victory over Motherwell, as well as the injury list that continues to grow. And during the show, we'll have the European draw as well at 1 o'clock, so we'll find out our fate in the playoff of the Conference League as well. So, loads to talk about. Tony, I was just saying before I came on, yesterday was a bit unusual for myself, so I had to watch the game this morning, having seen the reaction first, and I was expecting a horrific performance by Celtic. The only thing I saw that was a horrific performance was once again by the referee. But watching it, knowing what the score was for the first time and trying to analyse it, I just think we've seen a few of these this season, and I wasn't overly concerned, right? So I'm going to throw that out to you first, Tony. What was your thoughts yesterday? I didn't think it was ever in any kind of any risk of losing anything at Celtic Park yesterday. I really thought we controlled the game. Yeah, we probably should have scored a couple more goals, but under the circumstances, get the result, get out of Dodge, and we look ahead to Wednesday.
That's all you can do at the minute. Just keep winning games, because we're losing personnel as quick as we're winning games. So, as you say, get out of Dodge, get the 3 points, on to the next one. You know, and they could have scored a lot of goals yesterday, should have scored a few more yesterday, but they scored one more than the opposition. I don't care how it comes around, how it comes about. Celtic won the game. You work on style and finesse later, but this is a manager who's, he must think he's cursed injury-wise. He's not been able to play a settled 11 many times this season, if at all. You know, he must yearn for the day when he gets his players in, he's done his business in the transfer window, and he has everybody available. Yet, what does he say at the end? We don't moan, we don't bleat, we don't make excuses, we get on with it. I tell the team that, I say that to the players. You've won another 3 points, you keep rising to the challenge, keep doing it. And I know it's taking its toll in terms of injuries, but we keep winning games. We're on Rangers' coattails. We are the hunters, and we've got to stay that way. And you know what? I didn't think he played particularly badly yesterday. Scored a wonderfully rehearsed training ground set-piece goal. Absolutely brilliant. You'll go a long way to see a better set-piece than that over all the leagues in Europe this season. This weekend, it's brilliant. You can't underestimate the role Callum McGregor played in that.
Orchestrated it.
David Turnbull credited him with his interview after it and said it was Callum that told me to do it, and he ran two defenders away, created the space for Rogic, while saying to Turnbull, play it to Rogic, play it short to Rogic, don't go for a shot. Temptation to go for a shot there, isn't it? See what happens. And it paid off, and that's what you like about the Celtic team. They're actually thinking now, as the manager says, doing things with a purpose. Their purpose right now is to win football matches. They're doing that. I don't know what Celtic supporters want at the minute, because there's a lot of injuries, a lot of disruption to that team, a lot of disruption to the flow of that team. Just win matches, and that's what Andy's doing right now. So big up to them yesterday.
Yeah, I mean, when you look at the last 3 weeks, Amy, there's been a few similar performances. You know, the 1-0 against Hearts, 1-0 against St Johnstone. Then we've got yesterday's game as well as a 2-1 against Aberdeen, where you're coming away and it's quite narrow in terms of the scoreline, and it's not been the kind of performances that were described as rip-roaring previously by Tony Haggerty, copyright 2021. However, I wasn't too concerned. Is it something that concerns you? Because as Tony says, we are getting... I don't even think it's grinding out the results. It's not as though... I remember a game a couple of years ago against Hamilton where it was one each, and Scott Brown scored in about the 93rd minute in the rain Wednesday night, and you'd have done anything just to get the result and get out of there. It wasn't really like that, was it?
No, and it's, Tony kind of alludes to, you know, December is always a tricky calendar month. It's always a hectic one for most teams, especially then chucking a cup final as well, which I'm not saying, oh my God, we're in a cup final, because but you want to be there, but it does, it adds things up, you know, and it is a hectic calendar. So it is a tough month as it is. Do that without right now a recognised striker, then it's going to get even tougher. So I don't care how Celtic are winning matches, as long as they're winning matches, and that is all that matters, you know, if it's winning ugly. But I wouldn't even say winning ugly then, because I'd kind of more go on the, you know, how many months ago would we have said, you know, Celtic just can't quite get into the habit of winning? You know, there was the Livingston game. You thought a bit of flow was coming, and then that gets thrown in as a curveball, and Celtic just can't quite seem to, you know, keep it going. But they are now getting into that habit of winning, and that is what this Celtic side especially need. And if it comes away with however many 7-8, 1-0s this December or this Christmas period, whatever you want to call it, then I will gladly take it. And I don't think there'll be many Celtic fans who wouldn't take that. And I understand it might not be the most pleasant on the eye. And again, 1-0 can always be a little bit deceiving, and it's not the most comfortable because it is that slender lead. But not one moment did Celtic yesterday look like conceding. You know, and Motherwell, this is a Motherwell side too. Well, Graham Alexander's just won yet another manager of the month. Don't ask me quite how. But this is a decent Motherwell side right now, you know, and they grind out wins themselves. Sorry. Tony Watt, obviously, there is a little bit of speculation right now around his contract. But I don't think that's an excuse because I don't think he plays any differently than he would. But he's in fantastic firing form. You know, he is the league's top goal scorer. He certainly was at the time. You know, Kevin Van Veen, these are good players and they've got a solid team. And Alexander has them playing like that. Yesterday, they certainly didn't come out to play the way that Motherwell had been playing in recent weeks. But it's no mean feat. And I just think that getting that 1-0 and being a comfortable 1-0, I know that's not really what people think it is, because it is just a 1-0. But that was a comfortable 1-0. If you can tell me 1 minute in the game that I felt like Celtic were going to concede, probably except that ridiculous shot, you know, that bounced off the crossbar in the first half, and it was still 0-0. But other than that, there wasn't many times that, you know, thought Joe Hart made that double save, it was offside. There was nothing that I felt Celtic were under, you know, unimaginable pressure.
I mean, these are base statistics, and I know that the data guys and numbers guys like Alan Morrison do more intense analytics, but possession 71% again, Amy. Shots on goal 26 against 9. Corners 10 against 2. And I think that does tell the story of what you're saying there. It was a controlled performance. The 12:30 bulletin, just for anyone asking when we start, normally starts at 12:30 on a weekday. So in terms of us going a wee bit early, that's just to get the whole set up and get Amy and Tony in the room or in their respective rooms, and we can have a wee confab before we get started. Now, before I forget, how could I possibly forget? Look at this man behind me, the late, great Bertie Auld. All this big pile of goods here are part of the charity fundraiser for St Mary's. And I was just looking at it before we came online there. We're just under £3,800 on the auction, which is on eBay. The links are on the social media channels. And we're sitting at over 25 grand all in at the moment for St Mary's. So we'll know our total in the next 24 hours, but we are expecting a few more donations to come in before then. Can we beat last year's total of 27,000? We live in hope. It's all going to the birthplace of Celtic. Thanks, everybody, for getting involved. We pulled this together. As I say we, I'm not just talking about ACSOM. Everybody involved have pulled this together over the last 13 days. This was launched on the 1st of December. So fantastic work by everybody. And we'll be able to give them a big check just at the right time of the year as well. So please get your comments coming in on the social media channels. We're on Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitch, YouTube and Twitter. And we'll do our best to get you involved in the show. I'm going to hark back to Tommy Burns again, the Tommy Burns team, Tony, because, you know, the free-flowing football that we've seen at points this season has been reminiscent of the entertaining football that Tommy played. Why didn't he win leagues? Too many draws. So we're going into games like this and we're winning 1-0. How many times did we see the 1-1 and the 2-2, sometimes nothing each in Tommy's time? So I totally take on board what Amy's saying. I mean, 1-0's as good as anything at this moment in time.
That's what I'm referring to as well. You know, you just win football match, doesn't matter how you do it. We're fast becoming the Arsenal of Scottish football. 1-0 to Celtic, 1-0.
I'll take that.
You'll take it all day long. You know, it doesn't matter what the score is. As long as you score 1-0 in the opposition, that's an object of the exercise, isn't it? And the manager's seeing that as well. He's telling his players are constantly rising to challenges. They've been hit with every challenge possible this season, with injuries to key players, you know, big games coming up at moments in time when, you know, thick and fast. I mean, got to play big games, doesn't matter when you play them, but they're just coming at them thick and fast and they're dealing with it, you know. And that was a comfortable 1-0 win for me as it gets yesterday. I just, the second half, think Motherwell got out of the half, did they? You know, it was all constant Celtic. They squandered chances, yeah, and people can moan about squandering chances. Yeah, fine, but I'd moan about squandering chances if we drew 0-0. Well, right, we played Livingston, drew 0-0, never created a chance the whole game, and got a golden opportunity to score from the penalty spot and blew it. You know, so it's that fine margin, isn't it, in games? But yesterday we were well in control, well in command. I think if Motherwell had taken anything, it would have been an absolute travesty. You had the one off the bar, and Joe Hart's double save. That's it. That's all they did.
Mm-hmm.
You talk about one goal from 26 efforts at goal. That is a poor ratio, but it's still enough to win the game. We can work on, we can work on finesse and style and being clinical as we're going along. I'm sure the manager will get it stressed into the guys' heads this week when they go to Dingwall. You know, you've got to need to be more clinical.
Tony, I'll take a 1-0 up there as well.
Well, you'll take any kind of win, Paul.
Yeah.
Until such times when the transfer window comes and you get reinforcements, you just have to keep winning. By hook or by crook, it doesn't matter. It doesn't have to be aesthetically pleasing in the eye or rip-roaring, free-scoring, never boring. We want it to be that, but you kind of get what you want all the time. You just need to keep winning football matches. You know, that's the bottom line for Celtic right now. And as Amy says, having the cup final next week puts a layer of added pressure because you might well go 7 points behind in the league again, you know, with your game in hand, which you're going to have to win. That puts the pendulum of pressure back to you.
Mm.
That's assuming that Rangers win their game, but, you know, the way they're going just now, then you probably think that they will. So, you know, you don't think Rangers will drop points until they play Celtic. You know, it's going to be up to Celtic to eat into that lead at the top. So, yeah, fine. But bring it on. Let's go. Let's not shirk from the challenge.
No, you're right, Tony. As long as it's still 4 points when we go into the 2nd of January, then, you know, we'll be pretty satisfied with that, I think. I'm interested in a player that Amy brought up, Tony Watt. And I'm not going to labour the Tony Watt situation. What I'm going to say, though, is what I noticed about Tony, having watched him obviously breaking into the Celtic side, is the development physically of Tony Watt. Now, I think he'd be best described as a wee skinny laddie when he first came into the Celtic side, right? And you see him now, I mean, he's absolutely bulked up. And I keep using that analogy of the Ryan Christie scenario, Tony, where he goes away to Aberdeen, comes back physically completely transformed, and he became a much better player as a result of that. I don't think at this moment in time Mikey Johnston is up to the rigours of this level of football. And, you know, it wasn't his worst game by any stretch of the imagination, but I still feel that he doesn't have the end product. He doesn't get by his man, you know, anywhere near as enough as he should. And actually, down the left-hand side, I feel that we are so, so weak, because I feel exactly the same about Greg Taylor. I think we're so weak down the left when it's Taylor and Mikey Johnston. We have no physical presence. And unless he goes and does a Tony Watt or a Ryan Christie, I don't think he's got a future at Celtic Park. I know your thoughts on this already, Tony. Is it as simple as that, Amy? Because there's no doubt in his ability and skill, but he's getting the chances now. I mean, he got the old Mr. Miyagi treatment, didn't he? Sub on, sub off. Not many Celtic players get that. He got that yesterday. And I'm not going to use this as an opportunity to have a go at the young player. I'm still calling him young at 22. But I want to see him performing well for Celtic. But I'm not seeing it.
I think he gets a lot of leeway. And it's frustrating. And perhaps that's why he gets leeway, because we've had those glimmers, you know, of him beating the man, getting down to the byline when he was young. But you look at kind of the different, not criticism, but we'll go with criticism, that perhaps I'll give to Leo Abada, you know. And I think there's sometimes, I think he's definitely dropped off since he first started and whatnot. But you think, right, he's 2 years younger. He's also just came into this team. He's moved country, everything that comes with that during a pandemic. But I'll be harsher on Abada than I will be on Johnston. And I look at myself and I'm going, why do you do that? Because I think, I don't know why, but Johnston does just get this, like, it's just almost a right. And I think we kind of do it with a lot of the academy players. And I understand that, like, I'm a big believer, and you want the academy guys to come through. You want Stephen Welsh, you want Owen Moffat to be coming through. Everyone's proud of McGregor and Forrest, and that is just, it is the Celtic way. But Johnston, you know, we do all say young Johnston. He is 22 now. You know, that is not as far from prime. But at 22, if you're going to be established in the Celtic side, then you should, you know, kind of be there by now. And I know then that's also, I'm not saying because obviously Cal McGregor was a lot later, but Mikey Johnson's been in the setup for what, 4 years now? Four or five years? It's been a wee while since his debut. And I understand the injuries and whatnot, but there's just, there is a overwhelming frustration when it comes to Johnson when you watch him play. I think his decision-making more than anything is actually quite poor. I think sometimes he doesn't know if to shoot, or sometimes he doesn't know if to, you know, pass. And I think that's actually the critical thing. He doesn't beat the men the same. And again, I'm kind of with you. I don't think that yesterday was one of his worst performances. I'm assuming that it's not the injury that Wise came off. It's almost that he just can't, you know, play more than an hour right now. But even that in itself, I'm a bit surprised, because it's been a few weeks now his rehab. He has been coming back. But yeah, it's an overwhelming frustration when it comes to Johnson. I don't think yesterday is a determining factor if he stays or if he goes, but if he doesn't start, not putting in man of the match performances, but putting in notable performances over the next few weeks, I do think there has to be a time where we go, right, or is he just going to be a squad player, and is he going to be, have to be quite content with that, because he's not, you know, one of those starting 11 players then, if that you're only maybe getting 50 minutes of half decent Mikey Johnston. I don't think that's quite the quality that Ange Postecoglou is looking for.
I'm looking ahead to the cup final, of course, and I know we've got a very difficult obstacle in between now and then. But I'm going to shape the question a wee bit differently to yourself, Tony, because you'll be thinking, stop asking me about Mikey Johnston, Paul. I've told you what I think. I'm looking down that left, and I don't think we've got the attributes down the left when it's Taylor and Johnson. We know Jamesy Forrest came off at the weekend again. We'll talk about him individually. I don't think that's strong enough to start the cup final. And I'm now looking at the fact that Ralston's came back in, and I thought he just started off where he left off again. He just clicked right in, playing balls up the wing, brilliant defensive tackles, the usual. And I'm looking at the fact that you've got Juranovic as well. How do we get a wee bit more presence on the left? Do we start with a Bada on the left? Because I know he switched over there. If so, who plays on the right? I know Juranovic was playing there for a left-back playing on the right-hand side, up and down. So I'm now looking at the cup final and how much issues and how many dilemmas Ange has. Where does Mikey Johnston stand for you when it comes to selecting that team?
To be honest, I don't think he'll be starting in the cup final. I wouldn't start him. Ange himself said yesterday after the game that his hand was forced for Mikey Johnston because he was only meant to get 30 minutes. Going back to what Amy said about his recuperation and his rehabilitation. You know, he came on because James Forrest went off, mm-hmm. which is fair enough, but he took him off again as a precaution, and you're saying, right, okay, I get all that, I understand that, but he just doesn't do enough. You know my thoughts on it, you know, it's, I'm frustrated with Mikey Johnston because I think there's a player there. I think every Celtic supporter is willing him to do well because he is an academy graduate. They see the odd spark, but it's not enough. It's just not enough. And Amy said there, his decision making is appalling sometimes. Mm. You know, and for a guy that's been in and around the first team for that long, he should be better, shouldn't it? He should know. He should know the opposition as well. He should know how to beat players from certain teams. I think he's maybe suffering from a lack of confidence too.
He does look like he is.
I think he's a confidence player. Because mm-hmm. he won against Leverkusen and had a lovely wee cameo, didn't he? Made a wee impact. You know, and you thought confidence levels would be up. You know, and I just think maybe he needs a goal or something to kickstart it. But it's hard to justify playing him when he's not producing.
This is my concern, because I think as we sit here this morning, like you say, that's a laptop decision. Mikey has to come off. He's done his running. You know, it's a science decision. Aye, bring him on. Yeah. They didn't expect to throw him in as soon as they did, you know. But as we sit here, it looks as though it'll be a bad or right and Mikey Johnson left. That's how it looks as though, unless Forrest is back to full fitness or there's a miracle elsewhere, that's what it looks like. I'm just seeing there, breaking news, Champions League draw now declared void. There was an issue with Man United's ball not being in when it should have been earlier on today. So who knows what's happening there or if it's going to delay the Celtic draw, but I'll keep a wee eye on that. Playing with no recognised striker as well. Now, yeah. We have seen in the past managers deciding not to do that, and I'm not talking about Celtic. Now, Ange Postecoglou has been forced time and time again this season to be playing players in areas of the park that they shouldn't be playing in. And again, it happened at the weekend. We got away with it. But I'm looking, first and foremost, right, this has been forced by three injuries to Kyogo, Giakoumakis, and Ayeti. Three injuries, and we don't have a striker. So there's a couple of wee issues. We've spoken time and time again, and I know that you keep an eye on the B team, the Colts teams, Amy. We obviously don't have a player of a standard that can step up. And even if we did, they've not had the first team experience a la Stephen Welsh. When you need a player, it's not great to throw them in. It happened with Dane Murray this season as well. You would like the player to be, you know, bled into the team. Three injuries and we don't have a striker. That is unacceptable, and I'm sure Ange Postecoglou feels exactly the same. But doesn't it highlight, once we get into January, and we've been banging this drum for a few weeks, we cannot sign like for like. And what I mean by that is we can't bring three players in and let three players go. Because how's that going to strengthen the squad?
Exactly. You're talking about, you know, numbers. And if three for three, then that's... like, see, it's just a straight swap, isn't it? You're not increasing by any matter of means. And we definitely do. And again, I've been kind of saying in our chat the last few days that I have watched a few performances for the Colts this season and they are doing okay. And I know that I get pelted because everybody thinks, right, well, Amy's in the Lowland League anyway. But does it really matter? Bonnager 10 points clear. So,
a wee dig there, eh? A wee indirect free kick there, Amy.
Yeah, well, let's talk about him. But Celtic, they aren't sweeping sides away. And I mean, you know, mid-Lowland League kind of teams, that they're not sweeping them away. And that, from a purely Celtic perspective, that is kind of worrying, because that was the whole reason that these guys were meant to come in. They were obviously, they are coming against, and Tony knows this and you know this as well, Paul, but you're coming against, you know, 32-year-old men in the centre of the defence, built like a unit, and they do just, they up their game against the Colts, of course they do, because they want these Barons coming in and trying to, you know, beat me kind of thing. But Celtic, they haven't been anything, they have been far from exceptional. There are a few exceptional players in there, but it's a massive, massive leap from the Lowland League to then, you know, getting even close to a Celtic bench. There is the talk, so, you know, Joey Dawson, Brooks, Owen Moffat, because Owen Moffat has been in and around the Celtic side as well. Rocco Vatta is by far, for me, one of the most talented players, young players I think I've ever seen. At 17 years age, it is absolutely frightening. But again, he's performing extremely well in the Lowland League, but you think, right, is that's a massive jump. It's not a step, it's a jump to then make the Celtic first team. So there is that worry of where the merge from B to first team does kind of happen. So January, we all know how crucial January is going to be. So it's vital, like you say, to not go three for three. That if it's, you know, even if, right, fine, lose one, but you need numbers, because the squad size is it is worrying. And that was again an exhibit, obviously, at the weekend that we had no fit strikers.
You know, when I think about the lack of depth in that squad, people have been asking Tony about the amount of injuries we're getting. And as I said before, we will talk about James Forrest individually later on in the show. But is it not the case that loads of these players are playing too much? We've got such a small squad that we're getting to that stage of the game now where we are going to drop off. Had we had the squad where we could have more of a rotation, we probably, the likelihood is, we wouldn't be facing the cup final with so many injuries.
Well, you look at it, right, the strength and depth is always going to come back to bite you at some point. The manager said that himself. He's been alluding to that ever since August. He needed numbers in, and he brought in a lot of numbers, but it still wasn't enough. But you look at the way they've been asked to play, not just in football games, but in training, that high intensity, all the players speak about it, that training is just a replica of game day. See, if you're playing at that high intensity and you're not getting the rest and recuperation time, or sufficient rest and recuperation time? Is it surprised that these guys are pulling up with injuries? Because they've just been asked to go to the well too many times. And it's and they can't do it. Their bodies can't physically cope, which is why some of them are getting hamstring injuries. The sports science will tell you that. Alan Morrison banged on about 2 or 3 days, you know, maximum for the body to re-energise itself. But that's hard when you've got a game, you get Sunday, Wednesday, Sunday, and you're asking the same players to do it all the time. That squad is stretched. There is no way he can rotate, Ange can rotate it. So that's why he keeps bigging up the players and saying they keep handling every obstacle and challenge it's flung at them, because he knows he's asking them to do a lot. Mm-hmm. But what else can he do other than bring in, as Amy says, the Celtic B team players who probably aren't the best equipped to cope with the rigours of Scottish Premiership football, the rough and tumble of it all? That's why he hasn't done it, or he would have done it by now. And that is a glaring example of the fact that our squad is chronic in its depth. It's not the manager's fault. It's just the way, it's just the shambles that he inherited. And you know what? I think it's a big up to him as well, that the fact that they've managed to hang on in there with that squad of players for so long, and they're still hanging in there. They're grinding it out, winning ugly. Well, yesterday wasn't particularly ugly because I thought they played pretty well yesterday. But you know what I mean? It's a credit to the manager and the players that he's actually able to get them up and get them ready. You know, because the games are just coming thick and too fast for this squad of players. What we lost, Jota, Giacomatis, Kyogo, lost Forrest, Mikey Johnson still no right. You know, Greg Taylor's just coming back. You know, Tony Ralston's coming back.
Yes.
Off the top of my head, that's seven, which if you're firing on all cylinders, they're all champing at the bit. They're first-team players, or first-team ready players, as Jim Bob would call them. So these guys have all suffered this season. Callum McGregor suffered as well. Mm-hmm. You know, injured. These are vital cogs in your machine. I've never heard the manager complain once, have you?
He doesn't, does he? I mean, this is the thing. He just takes everything in his stride. There's going to be also a £7 million centre-half to throw in the mix as well. We take that up to eight. There's going to be managers of Scottish football clubs saying, what are you moaning about, you know, with all your riches and all these players? However, Celtic are going for every domestic trophy that we participate in. We're in the final of the League Cup. We're still in Europe. And in order to compete in four different competitions, you do need to have that depth. And we haven't had it this season. Now, I'm looking at James Forrest. That's becoming a bit of a concern now. He limps off again, Amy. He's at that kind of post-30 stage of his career. Is he going to be ravaged by injury? Is this something that we're going to see time and time again from James? Because, I mean, this isn't a knee-jerk from me. It was all last season, and it seems to be so far this season as well. Quite a concern, Amy.
I certainly hope not. I honestly can't believe that, you know, people think that James Forrest is finished and James Forrest is done, and that he's not, you know, he's been getting, you know, let off the hook for his god many years. I think James Forrest is still chronically underrated. And I understand that the kind of flip side to that is what I'm giving with Mikey Johnson. It's kind of what Forrest was for years for so many people, that he was just that whipping boy. But I feel the difference is so that even at that young age, Forrest was doing stuff. Like, even in that first real season where he broke in under Neil Lennon the first time round, you know, he was a starter for a reason, because he was banging the goals in and he was always beating men to the byline. You know, there's not a man in the league that James Forrest wouldn't beat to the byline. And I get then that now maybe that's not quite so much the case. I think again it's just so detrimental to Celtic, because he's just such a great asset. And I think what he offers is kind of what Ange Postecoglou likes, you know, that wide player. He links up really well, if it be Ralston or Juranovic kind of behind him. He knows, we're talking about guys who, you know the league, know the men that they can beat. And I just think Forrest is now also offering that experience up top. We've got a very youthful front three, and, you know, new to the league, all these little factors. But Forrest is that kind of experienced head. And I genuinely think that he would be a great almost like mentor to Abada.
Yes.
And I think that's probably what we're going to miss the most, because I just think it offers so much. So I certainly hope, like, to answer your question, that it's not, you know, going to be Forest plays two games, Forest out for 6 weeks. So if it is, then that is a real concern. I know that's slightly exaggerative, but I hope Mr. Miyagi can work his magic or something like that. There's somebody in there, because I love watching James Forrest in a Celtic shirt.
Nothing like an 80s movie reference, by the way. Tony, again, do we go back to the threadbare squad has been one of the reasons for this? Has he been brought in slightly earlier than he would have done had we another few options in front of him?
He probably has, but the manager's hand's forced here, isn't it? He can only work with what he's got. And would it surprise you to see Kyogo in the starting lineup on Sunday?
No, it wouldn't, actually.
Would it? I mean, he's been prone to throwing the old flanker in, the bold Ange, saying things and then just parachuting guys in from nowhere. It wouldn't surprise me. I think it'd be a greater surprise if Jota appeared. But then again, I'm thinking he might appear, despite the public utterances of being 2 or 3 weeks away or whatever. But then do you run the risk of putting these guys out for the Rangers game in January? You know, these are high-risk strategies that the manager's going to have to work out before Sunday, because the sports science will probably tell you that they're not ready. The players will probably tell you, I can play, or I can play some part in Sunday. You know, and lots of Celtic fans will probably think we should have enough to beat Hibs. But the recent pattern has been grinding out 1-0s and according to a lot of Celtic supporters, not playing particularly well. I thought they did okay yesterday. I'm not saying they were scintillating, but it was pretty commanding 1-0 performance. I never felt in any real danger. Other people read it differently and say, oh, what a mistake away from, you know, dropping points. But you're always a mistake away from dropping points at 1-0. But I still felt that Motherwell never had an attack to speak of in that second half, unless I watched a totally different game. So we're doing the job. Well, we weren't as clinical as we could have been yesterday. There's a difference. If we're clinical, you win that 3 or 4-0.
You see that thing with Forrest we were talking about? You had a good chance.
Yeah.
He also had two very good chances against Hearts.
Yeah.
It could well be that it's just that lack of sharpness. So he's coming in for a few, getting his back out again, and he's not getting that sharpness. He's not 100%.
There's a difference between fit and match fit.
Mm-hmm.
Liz will tell you that. There's a big, big difference, Paul. So maybe that is what's concerning James. He might be fit, but he might not be match fit and that match sharp and match ready, because I can't for life me fathom how he missed that one against Hearts that hit the post. I just can't, but it happens to all people. And I'm with Amy. I just think Forrest's contribution is immeasurable. Just look at his medal haul. It's colossal. And he's just one of these guys who just, he goes under the radar in terms of Celtic supporters, heroes, but he's the most decorated player at the club. And he's come up with big goals for the club in big games, in big times.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know why he's not lauded from the rooftops, but maybe it's just in keeping with his own personality. He doesn't shout and scream, and he's not one of these kind of gregarious personalities. He just does his talking on a park.
He does. He's low maintenance, Tony. And I think from memory, he's on 19 medals, so Sunday would be his 20th if he makes it, you know, which is an astonishing trophy haul for one individual player. Stephen Sloan joins us on YouTube. Welcome to the show, Stephen. I'm worried about our finishing. We are so wasteful in front of goal. We should have easily have scored 5 yesterday. And I think it all feeds into the same situation. We don't have a recognised striker. Some people are coming in, they're playing out of position, or they're not 100% sharp. And that obviously plays its part. Also, you know, when we're creating so many chances and a lot of these are coming in from crosses into the box, as we've said before, you know, how many points have we lost against Livingston this season? 5. Take those 5 and you're sitting top of the league. How many crosses did we have in those 2 games? 80. That's an astonishing statistic. 80 crosses into the box in 180 minutes against Livingston. 0 goals. So I take Stephen's point on board, and of course I'm just wanting my Les Ferdinand to marry in with my David Ginola, and that'll be that issue resolved. Now, we're talking about moments of the game yesterday, Tony, where you didn't think we were at any risk of losing a goal. Now, that's something that I don't think we could have said a few weeks ago. But I'll tell you what, since Carol Starfelt came back in, Amy, now, he has taken a lot of stick. I have seen assured performances. None of this hearts and mouths moments that he was giving us week in, week out. And, you know, Ange actually stood up for him, didn't he, in one of the press conferences where he said, listen, here's a player who signed and got thrown in. He hadn't even trained. He didn't know his teammates. And he's had to learn on the job, if you like. He's now kind of settled in. And that injury layoff, bizarrely, seems to have done him pretty well, because he's come back in. He's looking far more assured, isn't he? Another good performance yesterday.
Yeah, I think he's. I think that's the word, actually. As assured, I think he's looking comfortable. That partnership is definitely getting struck up. There's an understanding between him and Carter Vickers, which is crucial. You know, it's, you talk about partnerships and relationships, and a lot of it is always in that final third, but it's so important at the back. And we can't actually underestimate how good and solid we are at the back. You know, we're saying that 1-0 yesterday, we maybe had five chances or whatever, should have scored five goals, or five clear-cut chances, sorry. But the reason as well is just because we don't look like conceding, because our back line, they're just so in sync. I think Juranovic out there is absolutely exceptional as well. But I don't know, perhaps maybe what's happened over that little injury spell for Starfelt, sorry, but I'm with you. I think he's came back looking just like a lot more comfortable. I've seen quite a few interviews with him over the weekend. You know, he said how he came in, obviously, and he had to stay in a hotel and whatnot. Now he's got a little place. He's had family and friends over as well. He's really starting to love just Glasgow life in general. So that all combined, you know, he's just a more comfortable and happy, and life's a little bit more, you know, just there's a routine now, because there can't be anything, you know, exciting staying in a hotel room for a few weeks and not having that support network around you. But, you know, the relationship and partnership and the understanding that he's striking up with Carter Vickers and Taylor as well on his side, because that's important. You know, I think there's a lot of balls getting fed out between the two of them yesterday that was just like sharp balls, quick balls. He's almost understanding Taylor's pace. But yeah, it's great to see. It's crucial because, you know, well, I think most of us certainly now did think that we're under the impression that Julien would be back by now. But every kind of time that his name's mentioned, it's another few weeks. And it is worrying. I don't think anybody knows how long it's going to be until Chris Julien is back, because it always seems a different day and a different week, a different month almost every time he's asked. So for Starfelt and Carter Vickers to be in that solid partnership, it's absolutely crucial to everything that Celtic's doing right now.
They are building a really good partnership. There's no doubt that they're the two first picks at the moment. Big Julien often is forgotten about at the moment, Tony, because we just don't know when he's coming back. Jungle Lion comes in to say that even if he was back, you'd be struggling to get in there at the moment, wouldn't he? I mean, Carter Vickers, again, totally dominant at centre-half.
I don't know if you noticed during the week, but Carol Starfelt put out a Facebook post, right? Just talking about a player being happy, right? She said he went to buy his Christmas tree and two Celtic supporters served him and gave him it for nothing. Right? I don't know where he got it from, but then he was just like, and I didn't do it for that. I said, I never went in for that reason, but it's just another indication of a guy that's getting it now, right? And it's took a wee while to sink in, but he realises, you know, he's playing for a cause, right? And maybe it took a wee while to adjust to that. Well, I know it's a kind of daft anecdote, but it's just, he was talking about the fact that he's really happy, mm-hmm. you know, and it kind of shows now in his performances, you know, and things like that make you feel happy, that everywhere you go, people, I'm not saying giving you free stuff, but they're just lauding you and saying, ah, you're the man. And, you know, that's quite a compliment, you know, and it's something that they'll never experience again in their career. You know, Tommy Burns nailed it when he said, half the city hates you, the other half think they own you. When he's talking about the Glasgow Goldfish Bowl, and it's never a truer saying. But see, when you're owned and the people are kind towards you, you just can't help but think, I'm going to perform for them. And I think Starfelt took a while for that penny to drop, but my goodness, since his injury and he's came back in, he's performing. And him and Carter Vickers, I was watching the two of them yesterday in particular, because Tony Watt and Van Veen, were quite physical yesterday, and the two of them just swatted. Those two just swatted the two of them aside as if they weren't there, and thought, throw us it, give us what you got, because we've got far more in our locker than you'll ever have. And I was quite impressed by that. I was really impressed by the way they went about their business, because they can mix it up. People's criticism of Starfelt is that he's maybe not comfortable with the ball at his feet, but he's playing out at the back. And there are times when you can see that, but he's getting a lot better. And I've always felt that Cameron Carter-Vickers has just settled in naturally. You know, he just looks like a centre-half or a commanding presence at the back of the pack. And Julian will be in a fight if and when he gets back, still no definitive date. But you wouldn't break those two up for love nor money now, would you? Because you're liking what they're doing, and there seems to be an understanding and a partnership and a relationship developing, and that's that'll work out for the betterment of Celtic moving forward. But I just found that a bit telling that Starfelt put that daft Facebook post up, because, you know, it's a Celtic state of mind he's acquiring, Paul, I think you would call it. You know, and he's like enjoying it, and he's happy, and he's shown you that he's happy, and people love him, and it's maybe something that he's never been used to in his career, and he's liking it, and he's liking his surroundings, and he now feels a bit more settled, which is good, because you can see that in his performances.
You definitely can, because they're more settled as well on the football part. You've just brought to mind as well, though, that, you know, you do have a real issue in terms of the divide. It's something you were talking about there. With that Tommy Burns quote, which I think is a great way to explain it. But I was just over the weekend there quite saddened to hear that a fellow podcaster, vlogger, who goes by the name of Juddy, you will have seen him online, was jumped while he was out on a night out. Juddy Talks is his show. And he was jumped by four guys who, you know, preceded that jumping by asking him, oh, you're that guy who does the videos, the Celtic videos. So, you know, that's unacceptable, because somebody is doing what they enjoy doing and they're doing it well and they're getting their face out there. For that kind of flack in real life, as well as, you know, electronically in a digital world, for that kind of abuse, physical or otherwise, totally unacceptable. So our thoughts are with Juddy. Hopefully you're doing all right, mate, if you're tuning in. And that is a shocker to hear that that happened over the weekend in your spare time as well. Now, another one, I'm going to have to bring it up before we speak about the wizardry of Tommy Rogic. I want to talk about Nir Beaton again, because, I mean, he's a guy that he was much maligned, right? And we've been speaking about how Tommy Rogic is the player who has been reinvigorated by Ange Postecoglou, as has Tony Ralston, given his chance, came in and took it with both hands. But Nir Beaton, slowly but surely, is racking up assured performances again. And what I saw from yesterday, Amy, is a player who, and I didn't think I'd say this, suits the high tempo. He was a guy, I remember watching him for years, who slowed the play down. You know, he came in under Neil Lennon. He's been here coming up for 9 years. So he's seen the Ronnie Dyla years of Brendan Rodgers, Lennon Mark 1 and 2. He's now playing under Ange. And he seems to suit the high tempo. And I thought he was far more suited to a slower style of play. And time and time again, I've thought that Beaton would have been better moving on to a league that played a different style. It was too hustle and bustle up here in Scotland. I've been surprised by performances, and he's up there in the top three players most improved under Ange.
Oh, without a doubt. I think you've definitely went from being fearful the minute Beaton's name is seen in the starting lineup or mentioned or anything like that, to now, put it this way, I don't fear. I'm not sure if I'm always jumping with joy that I see him, but I think as well, though, the most crucial factor is that he's not getting deployed in a role that he doesn't play very well. You know, he's not getting played at centre-half. That's not where he's at his best. And I understand, and, you know, over the years, I'm not saying, right, well, then he should have been playing in midfield, because we've had far better midfielders than your Beaton over the last however many years that you've kind of, you know, probably you're thinking the last 5-6 years. In particular, but in that midfield role, he does just have that little bit more freedom. He's got a ridiculous, now that's one thing we all know he could ping a ball, you know, his range of passing is absolutely exceptional. And that's just what he's kind of been given the license to do in the midfield. I think because he has that little bit more comfortable still stepping back, I think he definitely enhances Callum McGregor's game as well, because it lets him be that little bit more crafty, a little bit more creative. But you know, Beaton's just that it is amazing, you know, just that little bit further up the pitch. He's not perhaps got the pressure almost of being that last line of defence, because he was, you know, reluctant to a little silly leg out, dangling a leg out, or a rash challenge, really. But he's got that assured back line behind him, that assured partnership of Carter Vickers and Starfelt. So I'm totally with you. I would never have thought that I would have actually seen a day that I didn't go at the sight of Nir Beaton's name in a Celtic lineup. But certainly yesterday, I didn't feel a lot of fear when his name was seen. And like I said, for me, then that's just a massive, you know, a massive rise really from the build that Beaton's handled under Postecoglou.
Yeah, I mean, I am of the same view. Tony, he's one of the guys, a bit like Rogic, which is bizarre now that I'm saying this, that could have left the building pretty quietly. And now both players are going into their ninth years at Celtic, and you're looking at them to bring that experience to a team that needs to be kind of gelled together. And I think when you look at Beaton now, I was looking at McCarthy the other night, getting a start, getting a full 90 minutes under his belt. And I was wondering, should McCarthy get another game to start, you know, his progress in a Celtic jersey? But we've gone for Beaton again, and I think he deserves a jersey at the moment.
Two things, right? The Jedi mind trick that I keep talking about that Angie's performed on, Rogic performed it on Beaton. And two, and the second thing is, I guess it's always been his natural position at number six, hasn't it? He's just not played there enough. And he's played in a position where it's thankless because he's made mistakes, he's been sent off, he's let, you know, his teammates down by playing in an unnatural position. But, and as I've said before, there's a player in there we beat on because his passing range is pretty good, you know. See if you just tell him, see when you get the ball, shunt it to footballers, you know what I mean? Don't try anything fancy. Just win the ball, break it up, and shackle other guys, stop opposition from playing. He's pretty good at that. And he's pretty good in that role. And but also, every now and again, if you see an eye for a pass, then hit it, because you're quite cultured that way. You know, and I think Ange now trusts him to do that. And he's clearly listened. You know, I mean, the transformation in Rogic's been incredible, and we'll talk about that. But transformation in Beaton as well. But you get back to it. Players have a natural position for a reason. He was always a number six, but he was never ever played as a number six, was he? And nobody, no manager, no Celtic manager can really explain why. I just think they kind of went, he's a big guy, he's a centre-half, he's going to win everything in the air, which he doesn't do for a big guy. You know, but he kind of looked lost at centre-half, didn't he? Mm-hmm. He looked uncomfortable, but yet you put him in that six role, and that's his natural habitat, and as Amy says, your heart's not in your mouth every time Beaton gets the ball as a number six. You're actually thinking, right, play somebody in, big man, or, you know, shunt it to a footballer or whatever. Or you feel quite comfortable in there because, as you see, you've got the two defenders at the back. So that's quite a strong physical presence, isn't it? From that area, from middle to back, or back to middle, whatever you want to think about it. So yeah. Decent protection, isn't it? So I've never been his biggest fan, but I get back to it, and I've spoken about this a few times this season on the pod. I can only assume that the manager's got into his head. It's brilliant man management.
Yes.
Because the manager clearly thought, do you know what? I can't let these guys go because I need them to do me a turn, because the squad is threadbare as it is. If I can get into their heads and get them to play their natural game in their natural position, I want to watch here. And he's done it with Rogic to the nth degree, and he's now reaping the rewards with maybe having a wee bit of patience with Beaton, because maybe the other managers didn't, because all these all and supporters as well, because they just saw the mistakes and they were quick to get in his back. Maybe took him aside and said, right, big man, there's a player in you here. What do you want to be remembered for? Your mistakes, or do you want to be remembered as making a contribution You know,
I'll be his testimonial, Tony.
Aye.
I'll be there. By the way, the draw is coming in thick and fast. Celtic are up. We're not getting Randers, Slavia Prague, PAOK or Karabag. But I'll tell you what, we're getting a much better update on our comment section than we are live on Sky Sports. So keep the comments coming in. And Kevin Graham's asking if it's actually going to be Partizan Belgrade. No, it's not. Apparently, according to Scott, there we go.
Norway.
Yeah. Didn't Ronnie Dyler play for them? I might be wrong. At some point in his career. I'll check that just while we allow that one to settle in. So that is our playoff in Europe. Had we asked the question at the beginning of the season, December, Amy, 4 points behind, cup final, still in Europe, there's no way you'd have believed that under Ange Postecoglou, would you? Because of the scenario he was in.
Not at all. You know, any kind of European football after Christmas, I think if somebody actually suggested that, you probably would have laughed and went, come on, you're having have a word for yourself kind of stuff. But it's testament to him, it's testament to sticking to his style and to his own kind of mantra, not really listening to the noise on the outside. And yeah, full credit does have to go to Postecoglou. Don't think many of us even expected Europe pretty much from the start of the season, never mind after Christmas. Anything in Europe was always kind of going to be a bonus. And I know then, probably because I don't want to say how well, because it sounds silly because we didn't have that many great performances in the Europa League, but when you look at getting 9 points out of that group, I think in four other groups, we'd have qualified with that. You know, 9 points, I think that is always kind of like the golden number, isn't it, Tony? You always say, like, aim for nine and you should pretty much be okay. Nine or ten, potentially. So it is a credit. It's not the best draw. I think most of us did want Randers. But, you know, there's nothing. If you've got a fully fit Celtic, let's hope we do. God knows what that even looks like under Postecoglou, because the man's never even had that. But we could put on Celtic will put on a show, won't they? So, to have European football after Christmas, it's a dream, to be honest.
It is. Now, Ronnie Dyler never played for them, unfortunately. I can't make that link. But he did play for a few teams in his time in Norway, and I think the one I was thinking about was Odd. There you go. That was a team he played for. He played 240-odd appearances for Odds BK. So, yeah, we're returning to Norway, and we have plenty of links in there. But we're talking about players remaining fit. Tommy Rogic is a guy who previously we discussed, Tony, that he could compile a DVD of all his best goals. Are we having a season where we could compile his best performances?
Without a doubt. That was always my bugbear with Tom Rogic. Goals elevated him to some kind of status amongst the Celtic fans that he was a wonderful player. He's now that wonderful player and he's adding goals. And I wrote my colour piece yesterday in the Celtic Way on The Wizard of Oz, both Tom Rogic and the film. There was film references shot through it. So there you go. It was I just thought he was terrific yesterday. He really was. And for a guy that's coming back from injury as well, you know, I said Tom Rogic that I never really seen him grab games by the scruff of the neck before, like the way he's doing at this minute. You know, he was the best performer against Hearts. He was terrific yesterday. He just now was onto that part, and he was terrific against Hibs at Easter Road. He was unplayable against Hibs at Easter Road. Perhaps yesterday he was unplayable. And he's just gone onto that part now, chest puffed out, give me the ball, I'll make something happen. Of all the players yesterday, you knew Rogic was the one that was going to make something happen yesterday. From the minute he got the ball, in the opening few minutes, carved Motherwell open, created a chance for, and you just thought to yourself, he's on it. You know, some players you know within their first few touches if they're on it. And Rogic at this moment in time is on it, and he's not disappointing. And you can compile his performances and goals DVD now, because he's starting to just, he's an 8 out of 10. I gave him a 9 yesterday because I thought he was that good. And he probably should have scored a second into the second half, but, you know, that's nitpicking really. But I just thought he showed a real lot of composure and an element of brilliant control yesterday. Just his awareness, his spatial awareness, he just sees things. sees football in pictures, doesn't he? I go back to it. There are guys in a park who function like snooker players because they're about two or three shots ahead of everybody else or moves ahead of everybody else. Rogic's one of them, right? You know, some guys are lining up the red and Rogic's lining up the next black and just, you know, he's so far ahead that, you know, you have to tune into that wavelength. You know, it's quite telling that Rogic, Jota and Kyogo, those are the kind of players that are on that kind of wavelength.
Yeah.
And can tune into each other at certain times on the park. So that's what I mean. Just that quickness and speed of thought in the brain. You know, and I said it yesterday, you know, I said, talk about the Wizard of Oz, and I said, he's no scarecrow because he's got a football brain and then some, right? And that's what he has. Rogic has a football brain. And thankfully for Celtic and Andy's, he's using it to the fullest and the best of his ability, and we are now seeing the Tom Rogic that I always thought was there, and it's now coming out in abundance, and it's brilliant. It's a joy to watch, actually, at times, just watching him play.
It's magnificent. He's 29 years of age on Thursday. Is this him hitting his peak, Amy?
I hope so. I've said it for years, though. I never ever wanted them to go. I got quite a lot of pillars last year because I.
You also said we should play Ralston at right back, Amy.
I did. Thank you for bringing that one up because that is one of my finest moments. But no, I have been a big fan of Rogic for years because I understand people's frustration because the glimpses were there a few years ago. But if this is him entering his prime now, then. Here we go because, well, kind of like strap yourselves in because the magic that he has produced over the last, you know, probably since the Dyla days, you know, it's been absolutely exceptional. The only thing is that it has been probably a little bit stop-start because of injuries and whatnot. But when he turns the magic on, there is no stopping him. As Tony said, there is nobody with a better football brain in this country. He is absolutely exceptional. And it is a joy to watch. And he just... You know, if you didn't know football, you'd probably look at him and go, you know, he's quite lethargic and he's almost quite lazy because there's sometimes, you know, you'd be like, oh, just make that burst in. But as Tony says, he's reading it, he's anticipating it already. He knows that it's eventually going to come to him. But the biggest change in his game under Postecoglou has probably been that burst of pace. You know, the goal, not at the weekend there. But when he's bursting in off the side and he tried it against Hearts as well in the midweek before, that's probably one thing you would never have said with Rogic is he's certainly not really got any pace. But even that, it's his long strides. What would take some players three strides, it takes him one. He just glides through a pitch. And it's a total joy to watch. And going back, both Stefan Johansson and both Harald Bradback both played. Bradback went on loan there and Johansson started his career off there, so...
I love that, Trevor. That's obviously who I was thinking about, Amy.
Obviously.
If you hear anything in the background for the last 2.5 minutes, it's because we've got a live band playing outside. So apologies, and hopefully we don't ruin your listening experience. But with the Wizard of Oz terms already used by Tony, the Wicked Witch is obviously personified by the Celtic boardroom at this moment in time. And there was another silent protest at the weekend, but what I did notice coming on for 79 minutes up until the end of the game was there was a protest against the protest with singing "You Can Stick Your Silent Protest Where the Sun Don't Shine." I've changed the lyrics, of course. Tony, where are we with this? Where do we go from here?
Do you know what? I don't dispute anybody's right to protest, especially about the issue, because the feelings are running high with that. But I just feel that it's detrimental to the team. I think Juranovic made reference to it yesterday, didn't he, in his after-match comments. You know, and if the players are noticing it, then I think the manager said beforehand, get right behind the team. There are other ways. You could do a silent protest after the game. People have said that, you know, to highlight your issue. But I think when you're in the stadium, you've got to get right behind the team. They need the support. You know, that they thrive on it. They feed off it. And I think the protest just brought a negative energy inside the ground. And then you protest to the protests. And you know, I'd never like the fact that Celtic supporters fight with each other. you're this kind of, I hate that. You know, we are all bonded by the common cause, which is to see the football team do well on the park. Get behind that. I don't dispute the Celtic sections of the support that are, and the issue surrounding why they are protesting. But you have to, I don't know the answer to it, because if it continues, it could affect the team moving forward, and I just don't want that. I want everybody's energy to be transmitted onto the team and give them the support that you can, and let the players feed off that and, you know, get that energy inside the stadium again, because I think that when it's negative, it's no great, is it? And when it's at full throttle, it's night and day. You know, the issue ain't going away until the board address it, and they could easily address it. And I think that's the frustration with the Celtic supporters who are protesting. But I just think now they've made their point. They can protest outside the ground now, for me anyway, because I think we need everybody on side, and just, you know, it's a big period coming up for Celtic, and they need all the support they can get. The players and the manager do, and the manager wants every supporter to get behind the team in the stadium, because you know what it's like when they're in full voice. It's a wonderful sight. So I would encourage the supporters who are going to protest to now take it outside the stadium and just get behind the team.
Some might say, let the people sing, and the people are singing outside. So if you can hear them in the last comments that I'm making, I'm not going to apologise because they're a very good band. But yes, we are coming to a close with our charity endeavours. The fundraiser for St Mary's is still live, and it will be live for a couple of days. We are expecting a few more donations to come in. We're currently sitting at over £25,000, which is an incredible total for everybody who has donated or contributed to the fundraising endeavours by giving us prizes or getting involved in the charity weekend, for example. So it really does bring the Celtic fans together, just like what Tony says. Did you get a wee blast of the tunes there? So here we are. We're at 25 grand plus, and we've been going out to about 800-900 Celtic supporters on the ACSOM Bulletin this afternoon. It's always an absolute pleasure to bring that amount of people together to talk about Celtic. And all that's left for me to say is thank you to Tony Haggerty and to Amy Canavan for joining me on A Celtic State of Mind.